So thank you all for coming. I'm Lorna Gibson. I'm on the faculty in material science and engineering. And every term, at the end of the term, I have one class that's kind of left over. You know how we have that rule that if you don't have a final exam, you can't really have much to do the last week. And so every term, at the end of the term, I give a talk on how I became a professor at MIT. And it's very personal. Sarah can tell you about it. She's in my class. She's seen it before. So, you know, I talk about my parents and where they grew up and how I got to get into engineering. And really part of the point of the talk is that I had no idea I even wanted to be a professor until after I'd finished my PhD, after I'd worked in industry for a while. I had no intention of being a professor, and I certainly never thought I would end up at MIT. So part of the reason I tell this story is just to say there's lots of different paths that people can take. You don't have to have everything planned out right away. You don't have to know where you're going today, you know, where you're going to be in 10 years. And I thought it'd be nice for some other faculty to give talks like this as well. And I mentioned this to our chancellor, Bahr, who's here. And she liked the idea too, so she has been supporting this little project of mine, and Ingrid Vargas has been helping organize things. And I just invited people that I thought would have an interesting story to tell. So today we have Arthur Bahr. And Arthur, in a previous life, was a figure skater before he was a professor of literature at MIT. So this is Arthur's official bio. I'm going to read the official bio, and then Arthur is going to tell you his real story.
They're very different.
Yeah. So Arthur joined MIT's literature faculty with a PhD from Berkeley in 2007. His first book, Fragments and Assemblages, Forming Compilations of Medieval London, was published by the University of Chicago Press in 2013 and came out in a paperback this spring. He held the Alfred Henry and Jean Morrison Hayes Career Development Chair here at MIT from 2012 to 2013. And last year, he was an external faculty fellow at Wellesley College Newhouse Center for the Humanities. Right now, he's working on two major projects, a book on the anonymous author of Pearl and Sir, and I'm not going to say this right, Sir Gawain.
Yeah.
Sir Gawain and the Green Knight. I don't know, how do you do a book on an anonymous author? How do you know who wrote it?
You don't. That's the trick.
Yeah,
that's the trick.
And a kookier experimental attempt to put manuscript studies and figure skating into closer conversation than they have been thus far. So, Arthur, it's all yours.
Which is to say, any conversation at all. So thanks, Lorna, for that introduction, and to both you and Chancellor Barnhart for instituting this series of talks and inviting me to participate. It's a real pleasure to be here. So today, I'm going to talk about teaching and figure skating and scholarship and imposter syndrome, because together they explain why I wanted to become a professor, why I almost left academia at various points, including after getting my job here at MIT, and why I'm really happy that I didn't. I was a pretty serious figure skater as a kid, and I should say here that Ingrid asked my permission to stretch the truth and say that I was a professional figure skater. This is in fact not true. I was never paid to do it, and in fact, on the contrary, my parents paid a very great deal of money over the years for me to have the privilege of figure skating, so I was not a professional figure skater, but I was serious. And when I started skating in the late 1980s, the sport had two very different components, only one of which most of you would recognize today, the jumping and the spinning and the music and the costumes and all that stuff. The other component consisted of using your blade to first draw and then retrace extremely precise geometric patterns or figures onto a blank sheet of ice. This is how figure skating got its name. You literally skated figures. As part of an effort to demystify this rather strange-sounding practice, ABC aired this clip of Scott Hamilton skating a figure at the 1984 Winter Olympics, and thanks to the magic of YouTube, here it is.
Bracket, as he would do it in competition. First, he steps onto a clean sheet of ice. There are no markings to guide him. He looks around carefully, mapping out where the figure will lay, raising his arms to indicate to the judges where the circles will fall. Remember, this is a two-circle figure with a turn at the top of each circle, and they must be exactly placed. He pushes off, makes the turn at the top, you can hear the sound of it, and completes the first circle, changing of his edge and riding into the second circle, at the top of which must be the second turn. And remember, it must be directly opposite the first turn. He has to keep his speed and his flow going. And as he completes the first tracing, he now steps off on an inside edge this time to make the second print. This is called a tracing, and it must be exact. Look at how he must twist and turn in order to keep his eye over the edge so that he can skate exactly onto the first print. Everything must work in sync here, and he must be steady. He can't have any wiggles or wobbles. In the third tracing, Scott goes back to the right foot. Once again, he traces the print exactly. The precision must be extraordinary. The judges not only inspect the print itself, they also mark him on how he skates the figure, his carriage, his flow, his smoothness, the steadiness of the edge, the lean of the body. Here he's about to start the last tracing. Look at the lean on the inside edge. And here the turn, very quick and precise. At this point, he simply cannot let down on his concentration, but must keep tracing, maintain the speed, and keep the turns complete and clean. In the silence of the ring, he finishes the figure.
I was 6 years old when I saw that, and I was totally captivated. It was so weird and so cool, this idea of trying to create these perfectly formed shapes on the ice. But as soon as I started skating seriously, I discovered that figures required a truly insane amount of work. Free skating came easy to me. I landed the very first axel I ever tried. I got my double lutz within a couple of years of starting to skate. But with figures, my progress felt absolutely glacial. See what I did there? And instead of, I worked really hard at this jump, and now I can rotate 3 times in the air instead of 2, it felt like I worked even harder at making my figures perfectly round, and now instead of making really ugly, bulgy circles, I make very slightly less ugly, very slightly less bulgy circles. This is not a very satisfying form of accomplishment, especially if you're, say, 12. And as a result, I launched even more enthusiastically into my free skating, where I could express myself and play to the crowd, even if the crowd in question was just my mom drinking her thermos of coffee at 5 a.m. God bless her. So what has this got to do with my other topics? Well, I started teaching around the same time, when I was 12 and my little sister was 6. This seemed like the right moment for her to learn fractions. So I asked for a miniature blackboard for Christmas, and I set up a school for our legions of stuffed animals, and she helped them do their quizzes, and I graded them, and I had office hours, and this is what I did for fun, mind you. And ever since, teaching has reminded me of free skating, since they're both a kind of performance that attempts to draw the audience in and make everyone in the room feel part of some sort of shared experience. When you're on, you're both totally focused on what you're doing, and sort of going with some kind of flow that's bigger than you are and that you don't totally understand. But of course, you're not always on. Sometimes your grand pedagogical gambit is a flop. Sometimes you fall on all 5 of your jumps. And sometimes it's not a disaster. It just all feels sort of flat for no obvious reason. And those failures both sting and make you want to get out there and nail it the next time. Now, I'm not breaking new ground here at all. Any musician or athlete or actor will instantly recognize both kinds of feelings that I just described, the sort of everything's clicking and the, oh God, that was awful, I need to try it again. I go into this similarity between free skating and teaching because the other side of my job, of any professor's job, is research, and research has always felt to me like compulsory figures. While they could sometimes be rewarding, they were not fun. They were work, grinding, repetitive labor. Any progress that I made at them felt nearly invisible to me and totally invisible to everybody else. And here I think it's worth emphasizing how solitary and even lonely research in the humanities can be. Unlike in engineering or the sciences, we don't generally have research groups, and we don't have labs. It's just you, your books, and your thoughts. Which is almost exactly how a famous figure skating coach described doing figures.
You're alone with your thoughts, and you're competing against yourself. It's how you place your thoughts with your feet, and how the two work together.
It took a lot of work.
I love this.
But the greatest pleasure in a figure skater's life is to do as close to perfect a figure as you can. And it's a thing of beauty.
When it's well done, there is no scratching. And there is no crunching. It's just a whisper. You had?
My figures were never just a whisper. There was a lot of crunching and scratching. This kind of introverted, isolated work is just not what I have ever felt best at. But it's not even really a question necessarily of what you're good at. It's more about what's exciting to you, what gets you up in the morning, and how you self-identify. Sort of like, are you a cat person or a dog person? Are you a figures skater or a free skater? I'm a free skater. I'm a teacher. And this is where we get to imposter syndrome. Whatever your academic discipline, teaching is a tiny, sometimes non-existent part of the training you get in a PhD program. In my department at UC Berkeley, where I did my PhD, teaching was depicted, not necessarily explicitly, but implicitly, as the chore you had to do to get your ridiculously paltry stipend if you weren't good enough at research, i.e. smart enough, to get a fellowship. And because of that, and gazillions of other cues given by your professors and fellow grad students, it became clear that research is what's actually important. Which means that if you decided to become a professor because you wanted to teach, to share your passion for with the material with students, you quickly realized that you're a cat person in a dog person's world. Now, it should surprise none of you to learn that when MIT hires professors, and when it considers them for promotion and raises and the all-important tenure, it cares above all about research. In this, it is like every other R1, which is professor shorthand for first-tier research university. And R1 jobs are the jobs that, as soon as you start grad school, you're trained to believe that you should want. Partly because, by definition, people get PhDs at research universities whose professors naturally tend to absorb their own institution's priorities and incentive structures into their value systems. So when I went on the job market and I saw an assistant professorship in medieval literature at MIT, as soon as I picked my job off the floor that there was such a thing, I didn't think for a moment I would get the job. I didn't even really want the job. I wanted to end up at a small liberal arts college, like the one I went to, where I could teach my small seminars of smart, earnest English majors and have them all over for dinner at the end of the semester to meet my boyfriend and my cats. I had it all planned out. And the only reason I even applied for the job is that the academic job market in the humanities is so terrible that you just apply for all the jobs and worry about happiness later, if at all. And of course, the notion that happiness is a second or even third order concern says something potentially damning about academic culture, and we can talk about that later if you want. So when I actually did get the job, I was super excited but also sort of confused. It was as if I'd won the figures event at a competition, which I can assure you I never did. And I felt like saying to my soon-to-be colleagues, two of whom are in the room here, I know you're the judges and all, but how carefully did you actually look at my figures? Can I free skate for you? Because that's what I'm actually good at. And they were like, no, we don't really need to see your free skating because figures is what we really care about. In fact, as soon as you sign this offer letter, you're going to be competing under a system in which figures are worth 95% of your score and free skating is worth 5%. Or maybe it's 90-10 or 98-2. Of course, there isn't a numerical formula. We evaluate everyone on a holistic and case-by-case basis. But don't forget, figures are what really matter. Oh, also, if your figures aren't good enough, after 7 years, you'll be fired, and you'll probably never skate again. So the reality, as I perceived it, of MIT's tenure system, which I just translated into figure skating terms, didn't sink in until I arrived here. And that's when I really panicked, since I was sure that even though I'd somehow fooled them in my interview and my job talk, there was no way I could impersonate a dog person for 7 years. Sooner or later, and probably sooner, one of the judges was going to look at my tracings and get this tone of incredulous scorn in her voice as she said, "How did you even manage to pass your first figure test?" That is a quote from a judge who failed me on a later, harder figure test. And so I did what I did as a skater, as a kid, which is on some level what I was when I arrived at MIT. I threw myself into the stuff I already knew I was good at, and kind of ignored my research for the first year and a half I was here. I do not advise doing this, by the way. I looked for other jobs. I even talked to my senior faculty mentor about whether I could somehow convert my professorship into a lecturer position, which would have meant a huge cut in pay, prestige, and job security. He talked me out of it, for which I will always be grateful to Noel Jackson. Underlying all of this was an almost crippling fear of failure. I'd reached the seductive conclusion that if I didn't really try, I couldn't really fail. If I focused almost exclusively on my teaching, which I really enjoyed, and didn't fully commit to the research that I knew MIT considered incalculably more important, then when I got fired, I could say to myself and my family and my friends and my advisor and all the people I was going to disappoint, yeah, you know, it just wasn't a good fit. I'm a cat person. They're dog people. I'll be so much happier at the University of Northeastern South Dakota or whatever backwater I got condemned to. And for the record, my dad is from South Dakota, so I can make South Dakota jokes. Imposter syndrome and fear of failure are both real scourges among students at MIT, so I want to go on the record and say that lots of your professors, like me, struggle with them too. And please note that I say struggle in the present tense. These are not fights you ever conclusively win. Grappling with imposter syndrome and fear of failure and perfectionism, which is another scourge, is more like learning to live with addiction. The shadows are always there, and you just develop coping mechanisms to make it through, partly by being open and honest about those struggles. So this talk doesn't come with an inspirational conclusion about how I ultimately conquered my fears and became the consummate dog person I never realized I could be. I would still rather design a cool new class than write a scholarly article. I will always be happier and more alive in a classroom than I ever will be alone with my books. That's who I am. Learning to say I'm not a scholar per se, I'm a teacher who happens to do scholarly work, was incredibly liberating, not just because it's true, but also because it helped me separate the research part of my job from my sense of self. Scholarship was just that, a job that I could learn to enjoy and be good at, but not some kind of calling or vocation. And that was fine. For other friends and colleagues whom I respect deeply, it's the other way around, and that's also fine. Teachers aren't inherently nobler any more than scholars are inherently smarter. All of this helped mitigate my fear, which was crucial because in scholarship, as in teaching, as in figures, as in free skating, fear cripples performance. Scholarship that's afraid to fail, afraid to be found out, afraid to be seen to be stupid, is almost always boring. And I would infinitely rather read an article that I passionately disagree with or even hate than one that puts me to sleep. And as soon as I stopped feeling guilty about not passionately loving research, it was easier to believe that it did actually have value. And here I'm not referring to mine in particular, but rather to humanistic scholarship more generally. It has always been really hard for me to believe that my scholarship matters. I wrote a book about Chaucer and medieval manuscripts. Some people thought it was great, and at least one very cranky reviewer thought it was awful. But fortunately, enough people thought it was good enough that I got tenure. But even if everyone in the world thought it was the most brilliant book about medieval manuscripts ever, it still wouldn't really feel as significant to me as teaching a class in which some students arrived at new ways of looking at the world. It just wouldn't. The cliche about teachers changing lives is a cliche because it's true. And it's hard for me to imagine anyone's life being changed by reading my book, or quite frankly, anyone's book about medieval literature. Here again, comparison with compulsory figures is really instructive. Lots of skaters hated figures, not just because they found them boring and lonely, but also because they felt useless. How on earth did etching perfect circles onto the ice help you connect with an audience or communicate to others the joy of movement the way free skating did? Lots of brilliant figures skaters were terrible free skaters, just like lots of brilliant scholars are terrible teachers. Partly because nobody could come up with a compelling answer to these kinds of questions, compulsory figures were eliminated from international competition in 1991, with the result that today most of you have never heard of them. This initially made adolescent skating Arthur very happy, but the joy faded surprisingly quickly. Free skating somehow felt less fun, and ironically less free, when it was no longer the activity that I had to earn by diligently practicing my figures for an hour and a half. As soon as I wasn't doing them anymore, I appreciated how complementary these two components of the sport really were. Not only did figures instill a truly ferocious degree of mental discipline and focus, they also forced you to be aware of literally every single part of your body, since they were so precise and the margin for error so tiny that a single muscle out of place anywhere could mess your turn up at the top of the circle, or your change of edge, or any of the other gazillion things that were there to be messed up. In this sense, figures were a little bit like basic as opposed to applied research in the sciences, intense labor with no immediately obvious practical value, but with the potential to pay off in unanticipated ways down the road. Case in point, I started rock climbing and bouldering last year, and when I was struggling, my best friend, who's a hardcore climber, said, just remember every part of your body matters, not just your arms. And I was like, oh, it's figures. And then I thought about each problem on the climbing wall like a figure, and it made a huge difference. But let's even concede a skeptic's point that skating compulsory figures or deciphering the handwriting of medieval manuscripts isn't useful. These are nonetheless impressive, specialized skills. Our word technology comes from the Greek word techne, which means skill, art, or craft. Your ability to make or do something, as opposed to just comprehend or contemplate it in the abstract. So etymologically, technology is our shared set of skills, crafts, and capacities. When one of those skills is forgotten, rendered obsolete by a more recent form of technology or a changing economy, something of our shared heritage is lost. And this is why the demise of figures makes me so very sad, despite having been so bad at them. Done well, both the activity and the results are very beautiful. And this short clip of Debbie Thomas doing a paragraph loop gives you just a tiny sense, a sort of glimmer of that, I hope.
And then it was Debbie Thomas's turn. She was in third place coming into the final figure.
The pressure was really on. This is a figure that really takes nerves of steel. It's a very small figure. The judges stand very close, and the tracing is so small. She did an excellent job. Very solid figure, very even, solid flow throughout this whole loop figure.
Those edges were wonderfully steady, weren't they? Look at the swing and the change of edge right there.
And just an excellent tracing, very close, very neat.
She won that.
But pretty soon, the coaches who knew how to teach figures will start dying off. And then this craft will no longer be part of our shared human technology. Now, I'm not seriously proposing that we all go back to thatching the roofs of our kerosene-lit cottages, or that MIT rename itself the Massachusetts Institute for the Preservation of Historically Significant and Inherently Beautiful but Obsolete Skill Sets. Although that would mean that our new acronym would be MIFSIBOS, and that might be a reason to do it in and of itself. But I do think that it behooves all academics and everyone contemplating an academic career, as I hope some of you are, to adopt a more capacious understanding of what's worth learning and what's worth doing. One of my colleagues calls the modern university the brain forest. And once you sort of stop groaning at the pun, I actually think it's valuable. Because like someplace like the Amazon, the university is a complex ecosystem. Some parts are less obviously attractive or useful than others, but the depth, the richness, and even the utility of the whole are diminished when any particular constituent piece atrophies or is clear-cut out of existence. This is not just an exhortation to remember medieval literature when you're an engineering professor on some committee whose purse strings control the fate of my future colleagues. It's also a reminder to me, when I feel like my research doesn't matter, that it actually does. Not in the same way as my teaching, but as part of an infinitely complicated universe, ecosystem of skills and modes of thinking and doing things with your brain. I wish that the skating community had appreciated figures enough to save them. But their loss is one of the things that inspires me to do my damnedest not to let the same thing happen to the practice of interpreting old poems that don't get read that much anymore. Most of the time, I don't love doing research, but I feel incredibly grateful that I have to. Most of the time, I do love teaching, and I feel incredibly lucky that I get to. And that tension keeps both activities livelier and more vital than either would be by itself. That's all I prepared, and I'm acutely aware of the fact that I barely touched on medieval literature, which is actually what I teach, which I'm very happy to talk about, or why I do actually love teaching the humanities at a science and technology school, or what my research is even about. So there are many topics for conversation, and we have some people and we have some time, so we should have a conversation. Thanks, guys.
Personal,
I really appreciate
it. So,
I'd like to open it up if there's questions for
I'm
curious, how do you like teaching like medieval literature at MIT as opposed to
like a I like it a lot for this reason. Engineers have different kinds of brains than in a good way than humanities people. So I feel like I'm like, you guys are really interested in structures and in, like, how things are put together. So one example, I was teaching Chaucer, and there's this big, long poem called The Knight's Tale. And there are these two characters who are sort of indistinguishable, basically, mostly. And when I taught The Knight's Tale at a small liberal arts college, I had a one-year visiting assistant professorship there before getting this job. The humanities students, the English majors, got very invested in, like, frankly, sort of boring questions of psychology, like, who do you like better? My sympathies are with Arcita, and somebody else likes Palamon, and this makes me feel this thing, and it just all felt sort of tedious. When I taught that same text here at MIT to all the engineers, I said, okay, so we've got this big, long poem, and in one manuscript, it's divided into four parts, and in all these other manuscripts, it's not divided into any. It just goes continuously. And they kind of instantly got that that's an interesting question. Like, how do you put this poem together? That's one thing I like. I think also I just like being outside my comfort zone. I like being challenged, and I think the students here challenge me more than the students at other schools would. I guess the other thing that I really like about it is that in many cases, like, precisely because they don't major in literature, mostly, the students, like, the one literature class they take is sort of like a glorious working vacation. And so sort of like it's where we get to read books, whereas with, right, the English major at a liberal arts college, they have to read books. Like, that that's their job. So that's really exciting too.
Are you still skating?
Not really.
Competing, but.
No, I skate every once in a while. Yeah, the MIT rink is open from October to March. And weird. A little depressing, actually. Because, like, my brain can still remember how to do all this stuff, and my body cannot do all this stuff. So I brought my scribe. You can see that I started skating in the 80s, because these are very 80s colors. So this was the giant compass that you used to, like, make the circles on the ice to learn how to, yeah, kind of does. So you did this, and then you would, like, you can see that you've got these screws here, and so then you extend this out, and it goes out, and then you set it on the ice like this, and then you spin it around, and that makes the little circle on the ice, or the big circle, in fact. The circles are supposed to be three times your height. So I do sometimes take this to the MIT rink and, like, go to an edge of the rink and, like, do my school figures. And And it makes all the adult ice dancers grumpy at me because then they have that much less of the rink to do their dance on. And all the college age free skaters are like, what is he doing? I've never seen that before in my life. So that also is kind of fun. So I do figures every once in a while, but I don't free skate. I judge. Oh yeah, so that's the other thing. I'm a figure skating judge. So I judged I judged nationals a couple years ago. It was super fun. Yeah.
So how do you become a judge?
It's super intense actually. So judging and academia are figure skating and academia are really similar. They're both sort of like very insular, kind of gossipy, sometimes self-important worlds that are really convinced that they matter a lot, and sometimes the rest of the world really doesn't care, really. And they've always felt kind of parallel to me because I was coming up the judging ranks while I was in grad school, and I got my national judging appointment the same year I got my MIT, my job at MIT. So basically what you do is you do what's called trial judging, where you go to a competition and you judge the performances and the events, and you give marks, but your marks don't count. And then those marks get compared to those of the official panel. And then there's basically an oral exam where all of the trial judges are in a room with like two or three of the official judges. And they basically just grill you for 2 hours. Say, okay, so you had this skater in fourth, and the panel had her in second. What did you see? Why did you do that? And it's less of, if you get a good JET, JET is an acronym for judges, education, and training. But it's somehow a person. Anyway, if you get a good JET, then it's less about like agreeing with the panel and more about being able to defend why you did what you did, which is actually really good training for being an academic, it turns out. So I joke that, right, it's not a joke actually, people think it is, but it's actually quite true, that being in all of those critiques, which is what those oral exams are, I was in so many of those by the time I did my interviews for the job market, you just get better at it, like anything. So even though I was talking about medieval literature with my colleagues who were both on my interview committee, it was that experience of being on the hot seat and having to think on your feet and react quickly is that's how you do it. And it's much more stressful because an interview on the job market takes like an hour. When you trial nationals, you're there for a week. And you're on event after event after event, critique after critique after critique. You start at 7 in the morning, you end at 11 at night. It's exhausting. So it tests your stamina as well. Yeah.
Can I ask you about imposter syndrome? Mm-hmm. So you said it's an ongoing thing.
Yeah.
So can you tell me more about that? You've got tenure.
Yeah.
So I think
there are a couple of things. One, I think part of it is the identity question. Like the fact that like in my heart of hearts, I'd rather teach a cool new class than write a scholarly article. That's not something you're supposed to admit as a professor. Like it's not something I feel like you're supposed to admit. Like you're supposed to care about, well, even the lexicon that we use, like when you ask a professor like, oh, how's your semester going? They say, oh, the teaching is fine. I'm not really getting a chance to get any work done. Implying that, what is your teaching? It's not, I mean, right? Like that, so there's always this implication that you should be caring, you should care more about the thing that I don't care as much about. So I think the way that I've come to grips with that is the way I described, which is that I'm, you know, scholarship is my work, it's my job, and I've become better at it, and I think I'm good at it. But it's not why I got into this profession at all. And that just puts me at odds with like the majority of my colleagues. And I just kind of had to become okay with that. Yeah.
I really appreciate your candidness. I've never heard a professor describe the emotional turmoil they go through in this process.
Yeah.
All the emotions you're describing are something that I felt all through my PhD, still feel to this day, and is why I ran from academia. I had no desire to be an academia, so I'm in industry now.
Yeah.
And almost everyone I speak with at work will echo these sentiments,
yeah.
But I've never had a mentor who has explain to me that I'm going to feel all these things.
Yeah.
And I think that we are not fully appreciative of the mental health consequences
yeah.
of this industry.
Yeah.
Particularly MIT, it's extremely pertinent.
Yeah. No, I think that's
Cornell is extremely pertinent as well. I feel like we're losing a lot of very talented and bright people from the academy because they're just not willing to put up with that anguish.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, I'm dead serious. I was like, I wanted to. I didn't think I could hack it at MIT. I was pretty convinced, and it, I wanted to run away. And I felt the same way. I didn't feel like I was scared to kind of admit to my colleagues who were and are also friends. I was scared to like say that because I felt like then I'd be kind of tarred, right? I would be sort of marked as not serious enough, not smart enough, not the right fit, right? All of these things that you hear. I think it's a real problem. I guess I just agree with you, because I felt the same way at Berkeley. Like my advisor, who's brilliant, wonderful, wonderful scholar, but she was just like, you know, her attitude was, you know, the time I was spending on my teaching was wasted, because it wasn't producing the article that was going to get me the job at the school that was like Berkeley that would sort of replicate. So I mean, I think we all have to, going back to your question about like what I like about teaching at MIT, one of the things I like is that I'm not, right, the vast majority of my students are not even humanities majors, much less literature. So I just had to get over the kind of narcissistic fantasy that my job is to replicate and perpetuate miniature versions of myself, right? And I think that too few, I'll only speak for the English department at Berkeley because that's where I did my graduate work. Too few English professors at Berkeley have realized that that is not necessarily their job. And that, you know, the message I got as a grad student was that if I didn't get an R, not just an academic job, but an R1 job, I failed and I let her down. And I was her last dissertation student. She retired. I remember, I mean, I love her, but she was like, "You need to finish your dissertation." She had this like really kind of growly sort of bulldog voice. "You need to finish your..." Can I swear? Anyway, she swore. "You need to finish your dissertation or I can retire." And you know, Anne was famous. She was famous for getting her students great jobs, or for her students getting great jobs, however you want to ascribe agency. You know, this one is at Cornell, and one is at Northwestern, and one is at Princeton, and you know, the list goes on. And so, and now one is at MIT. but that just raised the pressure, because then if I got, you know, the University of Northeastern South Dakota or nothing, you know, it was obvious that it was me, not her, that had failed. So, yeah.
I have to say thank you for the same reason, for being so candid about that. I'm actually, I'm a PhD student and going to graduate next year.
Uh-huh.
So this is kind of like every day sort of questioning for me right now. It's similar for me that because I'm doing a PhD in engineering, so it's kind of expected that I would really, really like research and mm-hmm. probably make a career out of it, but I don't.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sort of moving away from it, so I'm struggling with the same question of, oh, I don't want to do academia because whoever I talk to,
yeah.
I've actually tried talking to a professor and telling them, oh, I only want to teach, I don't want to do research. Mm-hmm. Can I do that in the university? And it's been flat out like, no, you can't do that.
Yeah.
It's like a ridiculous question.
Yeah.
So I think it's very comforting to sort of talk about this feeling so candidly. So thank you. My question is, why medieval literature? Out of
yeah.
all of the literature out there?
Because it's the best is the short answer. The longer answer, The longer answer actually goes back to teaching. I think if you ask most professors why they... I shouldn't be quite so... No, that's pretty... I think if you ask most professors why they became a professor of whatever, the answer is they had some amazing teacher who got them excited about it. And that was what happened with me. I had... first semester sophomore year, I took Old English with a guy named Howell Drescher Chickering, who goes by Chick. So he's Chick Chickering. And he was just amazing. I mean, he read the first few lines of Beowulf out loud, and I was like, that. I want that. And he kind of... I mean, I'd always been interested. I mean, I was always a humanities person and not a science person. Like, I was always reading books, and, you know, I got an okay score on the Calc AP, but, you know, like, it was not what I wanted to do, right? So it was always clear I was going to major in something like that. But, he inspired me. As for what medieval literature does for me, I think it's, like, I like the distance. I like the temporal distance. I like the cultural distance. I like the struggle. It's hard. Like, you pick up a 19th century novel, and, like, the people seem basically recognizable to you, or at least a lot closer. The plot makes sense, sort of, usually. You pick up medieval literature, it does not make sense, initially. And I like that. Kind of entering into a different world is exciting.
Kind of like along your question, because I've heard someone else say that the reason that they went into the profession they did is because of an like outstanding teacher. Doesn't that kind of scare you a little bit, that had you had a really good teacher in another field, your life would be totally different?
No. No. I mean, I did have really good teachers in other fields. So not to ascribe all our agency to good teachers, right? I mean, I had a great music theory teacher. I'm not a composer, right? I had a great. My high school physics teacher was really great. I appreciated his skill at teaching physics, and I did not want to become a physicist, right? I mean, it's not a kind of straightforward one-to-one correspondence. No, I love it. I think it's great.
Any advice to students who might feel intimidated by their professors, and how to sort of get over that and to see them as human beings who struggle, as you eloquently talked about?
Yeah. I think that there's a lot of, I think we're trained, so we're professionals, right? We're trained to be professional. We're trained to like have, anytime you teach, you're performing, and anytime you're performing, you have a persona that is related to, but not exactly the same as who you are as a person. And I think, I guess what I would say is for students to remember that just because the professor is, whoever their professor is a kind of polished and accomplished and excellent professional, and just because they're you know, they may seem forbidding, like that, different professors have different teaching personas that work for them, just to remember that they're people. I don't know, like, ask them questions, ask like, what was grad school like for you, or ask what do you have any pets? I don't know, like, I mean, most professors are willing to have conversations, I feel like that's a lame answer, but I don't know actually what else to do. I think we as professors need to be better at signaling that that's part of our job, to talk to students, in fact, not just to teach students, and that those are related but distinct activities.